You are about to meet William Hogarth, English painter, draughtsman, and engraver, painter pug to his friends. Not in his prime, but on his deathbed in 1764, a fortnight short of his 67th birthday. He is in his studio in Leicester Fields, now Leicester Square, putting with trembling hand the last touches to a portrait of himself. This is a pendant to the portrait of his servants painted 10 years earlier, and together the two canvases are intended to be a testament of his personal affection for them and of his belief that a man's immediate society should be a self-regulating community of equals. Hogarth's early biographers, however, saw him as strict towards his servants, and it is our conceit that they were perhaps resentful, for their master was born not much above their class and could so easily have fallen to it. His adolescence was scarred by his father's imprisonment for debt and his mother's fending for her family as a vendor of quack medicine. That he emerged as a painter was little short of miraculous. He is often said to have been the father of English painting, and is still praised as a painter's painter. Yet most of his paintings were intended for translation into prints, and it was in these, in sets of 4 or 6 or 8, that he told tales as complex and picaresque, replete with detail, as any novel by Henry Fielding, his close friend, narratives of coarse immorality, in which evil is evil and not a cause for merriment. In 18th-century England, Hogarth's engravings were powerful social and political propaganda for those who could not read as well as those who could. When he thundered against corruption, cruelty, and decadence, he used art as his battering ram against society, feeling intuitively the need for reforms, for which a generation later Jeremy Bentham was to plead with intellectual passion. Much that Hogarth saw about him in the London of his day roused his ire and reforming zeal. He loathed the urban horrors that awaited animals, cats strung up by their tails to fight, dogs hanged for misdemeanours, dogs baiting bulls, bears, and each other for sport, wayward sheep and weary horses beaten to death. We were scarcely less savage to our fellow men. While the rich grew gluttonously fat, the poor starved, stole, and were executed. The mad were imprisoned as sideshows for the sane. The prostitution of both sexes was an organized trade, and random and immediate sexual pleasure urgently habitual. Teeth rotted, bellies swelled, noses collapsed under syphilitic assault. Sex and body were dominant. The moral influence of the Church of England was in deep decline, and the parish priest as likely as any man to be caught with trousers down. With appropriate virtue, but not enough decorum and no pomp at all, Hogarth wrestled English art out of the dead end of propriety and into manners and morals, an area of social comment too tough for any other painter. The stink and squalor of Gin Lane and Bear Street, public punishment in stocks, pillory and gallows, the savage pecking order of men. None of this was pretty, but painter Pug saw it all and saw it straight. Hogarth, the compassionate satirist, had a turbulent career, and it ended badly, with mockery for his failed attempt to be another Raphael, and foul abuse for his last political polemics. Demented, senile, traitor and placeman were the insults thrown at him. He worked until within one day of his death. That last day, too ill to do more, he was carried from his house in Chiswick to his studio in Leicester Fields to see, for the last time, the most sincere and unaffected of his portraits, that of the 6 servants who had been so dutiful. But it was their farewell as much as his, and not quite what he expected. A man lies in that semi-conscious state between sleep and wakefulness. He hears the long-ago voices of his servants.